Yes, 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 yes.
Does everybody in here know, without a shadow of a doubt, that even if you've had what you would consider to be a bad week, it's better because you have Him than if you didn't have Him? Does everybody know you may have been challenged, you may not have been able to meet some obligations this week, maybe some things happened at work that didn't particularly go your way, maybe you don't have a job. Maybe there's tension in your household, but do you know that because you have Him, because He sits at the right hand of our God and He advocates, you understand that this is the best week that it could have ever been without Him. You got that, right? Amen. So, my point is simply to praise Him through all things. Amen? To praise Him through all things. Praise Him for all things. And as I speak, I am learning this myself. So please don't think I am directing you and I am speaking at you. I am learning this myself. I have my days when I got it and I think I've learned it, I've mastered it, we're good. And then something comes along and it's almost like that bowling ball coming down that alley. Boom! Right? Knock your feet right out from under you. You get up again.
Amen.
Amen. You get up again. You get up again. And even if you don't feel like it, you praise Him anyhow.
Amen.
Okay, there's something wrong. Thank you, Jason. You get up again and you praise Him anyhow. Because you know when it's easy to praise, when you're just kind of like yesterday, I wish so much I had been able to go to the Iron Sharpens Iron Women's Conference, which I heard was even better this year than it was last year. And one of my favorite speakers, my girl Valerie Burton, was there, and I would have loved to have seen her. But, you know, even in a situation like that, when you have 5,000 other women praising God with you, it's kind of easy to come out of yourself and just to give God all that you have. But it's in those moments when you may be all alone in the house.
Yeah.
And there's nobody, there's no cheerleader rooting you on. There's no music playing in the background to kind of get you in the mood. There's nothing but you and God. And you have to summon it up from down here somewhere and begin to let it churn and begin to let it bubble and make its way to the top and out of your mouth and decide that regardless of the circumstances that I see, my hope is in the Lord. My hope is in the Lord. I'm not going to believe what I see. What my eyes are telling me is real right now. You're not hallucinating. It's real right now. But in God we put our hope. Amen? In God we can put our trust. He's not a man that he should. Has he ever lied? For all those here who've had God lie to them, just raise your hand right now. Exactly. Amen? So let's go on to our message this morning. So we're switching gears a little bit from grace giving. We trust that everybody's got that. And now we've got a sanctuary full of grace givers. Amen. I'm just going to say amen anyway. I don't care. We've got a room full of grace givers. Amen. And we understand the takeaway. Somebody came to me and reminded me of this. I was so glad that they got it last week. That one of the major takeaways from last week's message was God is always trying to get something to us. Always. There's always an exchange taking place. But if we're walking around like this, and in last week's situation it was with regard to our resources, our, you know, our finances, we're walking around with 50 cents clenched tightly in our fists, and God wants to say, give me that, and watch what I do with it. We miss it because we're so busy holding on. So, same thing here. We're going to switch gears a little bit and talk about the lies Christians believe. And one of those lies is, this is as good as it gets. It doesn't get any better than this. I might as well just settle for it. Wait till it's time just to go home and meet Jesus. It'll be all right. I'll get my reward. But here on earth, this is as good as it's going to get. So I might as well just settle. Be okay. Get prepped. Over. Oh, I'm talking to nobody. Got myself in the room. Watch television. Full cup of stuff.
You can just go on and on.
Right. Have a drink or two. What the heck? Nobody knows. I'm okay, I did that, Lori. Don't die, I'm all babe.
She looked at me like, whoa.
Might as well. Who cares? Nobody knows. The trouble I've seen. But we're going to challenge that this morning because it really is a myth. It's a lie from the enemy. Obviously, that's why it has that title. We're going to try to challenge that this morning and put in place some practical how-tos. Like, first of all, how do we identify the lies? Secondly, you know, how do we replace the lies with God's word? And then third, just how do you make it, you know, part of your world? How do you make it an everyday thing? An action plan. Amen? Right. So to do that, I'm going to just turn back to Philippians. The major the scripture that I want us to focus on are the ones that were read with Paul saying, I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And then the well-known verse that many of us call on and maybe have on our refrigerators or have somewhere on a bookmark or pray, because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. All right, this might not be such a good idea. So I want to just go back a little bit because context is always important. Amen? We emphasize that here in Global Ministries, context, history, setting, all that. So Paul here is, this is the response. He's been given a gift, support for him and his work, his missionary work, and he's thanking them. He gets out, you know, at the beginning of the letter, he's thanking them. And one of the things that I came across, which was kind of interesting to me, is that the word hope appears 16 plus times, depending on your version, in this book of Philippians. But the even more interesting thing to note is where Paul was when he was writing this. He's in prison. So that tells us right off the bat that our hope, that our perspective is critical, and that it's not dependent on our environment. It doesn't need to be dependent on our environment. Because if this man could write a letter like this, they focused on continuing to focus on the gospel, continuing to focus on what God has been, what God is doing, and what God has done, and thanking them for what they've given him. And just really thanking him, I mean, focusing on the spreading, the continued spreading of the gospel. If he can do that from a place of imprisonment, physical imprisonment, then what do any of us have to say? And as bad as we may think prisons are now, you know, our prisons are like club beds compared to what this was, a hole, you know, a cave, maybe, rats. No bathroom. I mean, just think of the worst of the worst of the worst. And the fact that in some countries, that's what prison still is like. But, you know, we have buildings, and there's heat, and there's air conditioning, and there's a cafeteria. There's, you know, all these things. We're allowed visitors, all these things. So chapter 4, verse 4, where he says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication. In everything by prayer and supplication, make your petitions known to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." So we're talking about, we're looking at a man who had perspective. He is able to encourage others in spite of his situation. So then, what I was just saying, I'm going to go to verse 9. It says, "Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice." That means it's a part that we play. Amen?
Yeah.
Put it into practice. We can't just see it, read it, know about it, read the book, get the t-shirt. We've got to put it into practice. And that's what he is saying to them here. He says, "And the God of peace will be with you." Now, "I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it." Then he says, "I'm not saying this because I'm in need, for I have learned to be content." And he goes on. And so I wanted just to stop right there, because why was he in personal need? Certainly he had needs. He had to have needs. But his perspective wasn't on those needs. His mindset wasn't on those needs. And that's why he's able to say, "I have learned the secret of being content." So if he learned it, what does that tell us? He didn't always know it. If he learned it, he didn't always have it. This wasn't just, you know, we sometimes we tend to think about biblical characters in a you know, almost a fantasy, a kind of, you know, glamorous kind of way. That they just had it like that. They could just do it. You know, they walked with the Lord, and not Paul's case, but you know, they walked with the Lord, they did all these things, they were so, they were like super Christians. No, they were just like you and me. We see that in, you know, earlier accounts. Everybody remembers Peter, right? We know Peter had ADHD, right? We know that. Peter was a little impulsive, right? We love him, but he was a little impulsive, right? We know that. There are times we want what? We want to strike out on Jesus' behalf, and Jesus had to rebuke them. Right? Intentions were good. Wrong time, wrong place. I don't need you to do that. So we know that they weren't perfect people. We know that they were people just like us. But sometimes I just wanted to address that and highlight that, because sometimes we tend to think, "Oh, well, they can do it because, you know, if they can do it, we can do it." So he learned the secret of being content. Didn't always have it. He may have had to change some things. And I contend that what he had to change was his perspective. So I want to just ask you to pause for a minute right now and ask you to think. And be honest with yourselves. Is there a situation or circumstances you are in right now that exist in your life where you have honestly said, "This is as good as it's going to get"? This is never going to change. I'm probably going to die with this. You know, the way that we began to come out of agreement with the lies that the enemy tells us is by first confronting them and acknowledging that they exist. And that's not always easy, because sometimes you've done it for so long that it's like your best friend. And you don't recognize it for the lie that it is, because you've been living with it so long. But the starting place for uprooting the enemy's lies is that first we acknowledge them and we come out of agreement and decide we're no longer going to believe them, and we're going to replace our negative thoughts, our stinking thinking, with God's word. Amen.
Amen?
Can I have the first slide, please? The table. I'm going to ask you to be brave. Nobody has to know what it is. I promise you, I'm not past words. I'm not going to call you up here and ask you a bunch of questions. I'm going to ask you to just raise your finger if you thought of something that you look at like that. This is never going to change. I've lived like this for so long. We've just always been it. To raise your finger if you've ever. No, thank you, Angie, for being brave, to raise your finger. Because I've been there. I've been there. In order to even raise your finger, you may have to first address some things. And that's what we put up here. Thank you, Lori. Line number one. Say it with me. It's my business. I don't want anybody knowing my business. Okay. Newsflash. You can walk with a price. You don't have business. Everything to do with you is connected to God. And He longs for the opportunity to take that thing that you are so hopeless about, that you think it's your secret, and turn it into a testimony. Amen?
Yeah.
But you got to be willing to come out, shift the mindset, and come out of that place where you're so protective of it. You're willing to protect it to your detriment. It's making you sick. It's making you depressed. It's making you argumentative. It's not allowing you to succeed on your job. You don't have any friends. People see you come and they're like, oh, Lord. I know it's a complaint. But you're willing to hold on to it and protect it. If I raise my finger, next one, please. If I raise my finger, people will be talking about me. Okay. Well, yeah. They may already be talking about you. So it's okay. But what about this? What about believing that maybe there are some people sitting next to you or in front of you or behind you or your pastors or your, and other ministers who want to pray for you.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
What about, we can't pray for what we don't know about.
Amen. That's
right. Got discernment, but not to give to mind, maybe. What about if people knew, thinking, replacing what you think, the lie, which is that they'll talk about me, but maybe they'd be praying for me. Amen?
Amen.
Third, what's the point? It won't change. Confess your sins one to another so that you may be. Confess your sins one to another. I know this is a Bible literature, so I'm not even going to play with you. Confess your sins one to another so that you may be. Then my question to you is, if you don't want to believe the scripture, is keeping your secret helping you? And the famous words of Dr. Phil, how are they working out for you? Right? How is that working out for you? Next, I'm the only one dealing with this type of issue.
Yep.
Now you know. You live long enough. You've been there, you've done that, if not, it's coming. We all have stuff. You don't escape this earth without a mess. But it's the hope. When we began this message this morning, praising the Lord, it's the hope that you have in Him that He may not always change the situation, but you have the hope that He's going to bring you through. You have the assurance He's going to bring you through. And then He has the ability to change your mindset, your perspective, when you're going through. I have a situation in our family right now that's very painful. As a mom, it hurts. And I had to grab hold of it and come out of it, acknowledge the hurt. Absolutely, that's there. My line is not there. But go back to God. I remember you said this to me about this situation. So even though today it looks ugly, I'm not going to dwell in that place. Dwell in that place. Too many of us dwell in that place. Amen?
Yeah.
We dwell in that place of sadness or just rejection. You know, we dwell in that place of despair. Thank you, Sister Mary. We dwell in that place. I had to grab hold of it. First of all, this too will pass. It's a season. And Lord, I'm going to choose to believe what you have said about the situation rather than what I see today and move on. Amen? But again, you'd be surprised how many people are going through things. I'm going to go out on a limb here and just read off some things, some issues that you may be dealing with. Next one, please. Okay. You don't have to. Tell me. This is as good as it gets about my life. How many, rhetorical question, how many of you are living with some things that you created? And it feels like, so you know when you're living with a negative situation that you created, it's one of the tricks the enemy likes to play. Well, you brought it on yourself. So now you gotta live with it. Mm-hmm. I see some head nod. That's right. That may be true. We're not perfect people. All of us have made mistakes. And just like we talked about last week, the law of sowing and reaping, so it is in the spirit, is absolutely the same in the physical realm, right? So if you have sown into some negative stuff, there will be a harvest. Unfortunately, there will be a harvest, and it may be a negative harvest, but that condemnation, that's not of God. That's not of God. Like, you know, why do you even pray about this? Why do you even tell other people, ask other people to pray about this? Because after all, I brought it on myself.
Right.
You hear that in your head? Know the enemy's talking to you.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Know the enemy's talking to you. This is as good as it will get on my job. Mm-hmm. Other people are more equipped or smarter or better educated or more experienced or whatever. I'm too old. So let me just kind of settle in and snuggle up with misery and let it be okay. My relationship with my family, this is as good as it's going to get. I know, you know, we all have got it. Family's just family, isn't it?
Yeah.
Family is just family. We've all got some situations that are less than ideal. We might say to ourselves, you know what, they've been crazy like ever since I've known them. Or we never did get along. You know, even as kids, we just never did get along. Or, you know, I remember, nobody knows what they did to me, so this is as good as it's going to get. My financial situation, my appearance. There's a lot of research out about the relationship between our social-emotional well-being and our appearance, the care we put into ourselves. You can tell a lot about where a woman is, in particular, women. Men, because you know what, men put on weight. It's like a status symbol sometimes. The suits kind of fit them better. I don't know. But all I know is it's not the research about men that it is about women. You know, they get a little bit of a belly and it's a sign that, you know, their pots are full. They got plenty of food in the house. We get a little bit of belly. Nobody remembers, but we had babies. But there's a lot of research about that. There's a lot of research about that. And so oftentimes, the secret that we as women think we're hiding, we wear it with us every day. We take it to work with us. We take it to the gym or not to the gym. We take it with us every day. Again, how do I know? Been there. Done that. I had probably the worst so you at such and such event. And I didn't put on weight or anything, but I just was just dried up and just kind of like, blah. And she said to me, my husband and I talked, and we were going to come to groups and to say, like, if she doesn't start to change and, you know, get back to being the old parent, we were going to have a serious conversation with you. You know what? I could have been offended, but I thank God for a friend like that who could see what I couldn't see at that moment.
Hallelujah.
And when she said it, it was kind of like a, you know, and I kind of looked at myself and realized, like, you know, that black lawn every day, don't care. And in part, for me, it was about some unsettled issues from my childhood that had been tapped into through my pregnancy. And when my son was born, the thought of leaving him and going back to work was unbearable. And that's what it was. I was approaching the end of my maternity leave, and I was just a mess, but I couldn't see it. So I thank God for the body of Christ. Can we just thank God for the body of Christ?
Amen.
Thank
you. Yet I will argue my ways to his face.
the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things unseen. Romans 5, 2 through 5, I love this. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Romans 8, 24, 25. For in this hope we were saved. Now, hope that is seen is not even hope. If I can see it, I don't know for it. It's there, it's tangible. I can reach up with my hands on it. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Rejoice, Romans 12. Rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer. These are some takeaways today. I hope you're beginning to get them. Change the mindset. Be in prayer. Replace whatever you've been thinking. For however long it's been there, it can be replaced.
Yeah.
Romans 15:4. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have. Romans 15:13. May the God of fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen. I encourage you today to just think about what kind of mindset you have. Valerie Burton, who I just mentioned in her new book, Successful Women Think Differently, she talks about a growth mindset and a fixed mindset. And I just want to just throw that out for you today. The fixed mindset embraces the lies, this is kind of my paraphrase, the discouragements of life. It allows for excuses to become bigger in our lives than God is. It allows for doom and gloom to become our best friend. So the fixed mindset really doesn't have any elasticity, you know, to it. It is what it is. We just have to trudge along and just make the best of life. That is not what he died for. I'm sorry. That is a waste of time, if that's what he died for. Seriously. But the fixed mindset, how many people know when there's no hope, excuses have to do? When there is no hope, excuses have to do. There's a reason why I can't do this. There's a reason why I'm like this. That may all be true. But hope. That may all be true. I got it. I got the story. I know. Some of you know part of my testimony. And I always thank God. And that's why I have hope in all situations.
That's right.
Because I say to myself, Lord, the trajectory that the enemy had me on would not have led me to here. So I can only thank you. I can only acknowledge you for it. And even when situations just seem bleak, and even when I have my down times, my down moments, maybe even my down season, I know that I have to get up. I don't have any choice. He's done so much. I don't have the right to claim his name and walk around looking like doom and gloom. We don't. It's unfair. We're reconciled. We're ambassadors for him. We're ambassadors. The growth mindset allows for God's word to shine its truth in our circumstances, as we see in Romans 12:1-2. Be ye not conformed, shaped, influenced by the circumstances of this world, but instead embrace the choice that you have by being transformed. For those for whom this may seem a little bit tough, close now, but I just want to ask you a few questions. Anybody in here physically incarcerated? Right. No. Anybody in here dead? Just touch the person next to you, make sure they're still breathing. Okay. Everybody alive and breathing? That means you can have hope. That means you can do it. That means there's still time.
Yeah.
I sit around sometimes talking to my mother, who many of you know, and many of you have heard me talk. I'm just funny to you this morning, aren't I? Many of you know or heard me talk about, she is 88 years old. And she still gets up every day with purpose and hope. to, you know, to get it together and to get out of that house. And she had to coordinate a lot of stuff. But I thank God for that model. Because I look at her and I'm like, oh, I have no complaints. I don't have anything to say. Life is good.
Yes, yes.
But the fact that she has a purpose in her mind that until the day that she is called home, she has purpose. She has hope. There's a reason every day for her to get up. And whether it's she goes to they serve meals at her church, they do all these different things at her church. And sometimes there's a part of me that's just like, Mom, you've done it long enough. Let somebody else do it. That's part of her purpose that she continues to live out and that she's going to live out until she closes her eyes. That's part of I have a trait, tendency or something to rarely accept things that are and just be okay with them. I'm kind of always challenging, always thinking, always wanting to know how we can do this better, or how this can be different, why is this, why is that. And in fact, when I was a little, I'm the youngest, but when I was little, my sister used to often say, can't you just take things as they are? Why do you have to question everything? Just shut up. Stop asking my questions. Stop asking this. Stop doing this. I don't know. God just kind of put that in there. I can't help it. But I realized it comes from my mother. Because she doesn't accept things as they are. Still, you know, at this age, she's challenging herself to do better. She's challenging herself not to take things as they are. She, oftentimes, when I hear her pray, it'll be, you know, Lord, continue to search me. Still, if there's anything in me that's not pleasing to you, at 88, almost 90, Lord, I invite you to take it out. So even if my change is only for another 30 days, let's just say, you know, even if my change is only for another 30 days or for another year, I want to do it to your glory. I want people to see what can be done. And with this little frail body that doesn't have much elasticity left, much cartilage, much anything, you know, left, I want people to see what can be done. But even at this age, you surrender yourself to Him. So again, seeing no one here. Dad, everybody, check the person next to you. Everybody breathing? Got a heartbeat? Blood flowing? You're good? Okay, well, then that means change is possible. Amen? But if you have a fixed mindset and you want to embrace what Paul said, I've learned the secret. I know what it is to have, I know what it is not to have. But I've learned the secret to being content. I've learned the secret to being content. And finally, just a last thing I just want to say. How many have heard the expression, show me your friends and I'll show you you? I'm not trying to tell anybody what to do. But if everybody you hang out with has got a negative perspective on life, how do you think things are going to get better? Are you influencing them or are they influencing you? What's going on? If everybody is a complainer that you know, if everybody sees a glass half empty, if there's somebody here who sees a glass half full, please. I got up when I was getting ready to get up this morning and I looked and I saw a lot of holes in the congregation. A lot of people kind of went to my head of who was here and who wasn't here. For a split second, I was like, oh, right, it's raining, so of course people can't come to church. And then I was like, you know what, thank God that the people who need to hear the message, who I've designed to be here for this day, who I've purposed to be here for this day, those are the people who are here, and they are going to take away my word, can't come back away, they're going to take away the message, they're going to take away the message. Get up there and ask God to help you be the best wife you can be, the best husband you can be, the best brother, the best son, the best. Get up there and just get in the game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah.
Ask God to help you. And not focus on, nobody here is in prison like Paul was. So if he can write a letter like that of hope and encouragement, then so can we.
Yeah.
But we've got to replace what we think with the word. got to be willing to do that. You've got to really hate what God hates, love what God loves. And some of you may have to replace the people you hang out with.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Or at least challenge. You be the one who challenges. You listen to a complaint or two and just, you don't have to stop people. You're like, do you have anything wrong with you to say? People will check themselves when you start doing that. Or, I'm not doing this, the church doesn't do that. Are you doing anything better? You're not. Okay, so when you get in the game and start making it better, then we can talk again. Okay? So, bold steps and be honest with yourself. Embrace the growth mindset instead of the fixed mindset. Choose the Lord that's called it above his circumstances and not be limited by what you see, the four walls around you or the situation that you find yourself in. In your middle of your